Hi guys, welcome back. This is Matt Chat, episode 358, featuring the third and final installment of my interview with Mr. Don Wilkins, the developer of Stellar Tactics. In this segment, we finally get around to talking about his game, Stellar Tactics, and we've got a nice lengthy discussion here about all about the game, about what it was like developing this as a one-man band, the pluses and minuses of that system. We talk about the tools that he used to create the game, his plans for the future, and much, much more. A lot of great stuff here, so without further ado, here is Mr. Don Wilkins. Okay, so let's talk about Stellar Tactics. Sure. I just got finished playing it. I had to tear myself away from it. I just found the... I got the sample into that lab machine. It's a very scary game. I wasn't expecting it to be so sort of terrifying, but anyway, we can talk about that. So if you haven't seen this game, I was trying to think of sort of games it reminded me of, and I thought there might be some... Well, you mentioned a couple already with the Sentinel Worlds, I guess.
Sure.
But Starflight, Sundog, Frozen Legacy. So if you remember those games, I think you'd definitely be interested in this. But there's also some... it kind of reminded me of some newer games as well. I see maybe a little bit of a Mass Effect, Wasteland 2, Shadowrun, XCOM, games of that sort. I mean, what would you say for somebody that's trying to figure, what is this game like? You know, what games would you compare it to?
I think you picked up on a few of them. XCOM, Jagged Alliance, a little bit of Jagged Alliance in there.
I see that, yeah.
All the way back to some of the Gold Box games, you know, a bunch of people on the forums picked up on it right away, but it was, I can't believe, Buck Rogers. I don't know if you remember the Buck Rogers Gold Box series games.
What was that called?
Yeah, you know, it's really funny.
Countdown to Doomsday or something?
Exactly. Countdown to Doomsday. And that was an influence on the game, most certainly. Wasteland, Fallout 1 and 2, all my favorite kind of games. I really like sort of a slower pace. Mm-hmm. And a little bit more of a thinking game, some strategy, character development. So let's see. You've made it to that part where you've put the sample in the lab. There's quite a bit more. You might have a couple surprises ahead.
Yeah, I've already had to reload a couple times.
Yeah, there's a couple of tough boss fights coming up too. So I actually had a person rage quit last week.
Rage quit.
Seriously, I cannot defeat this boss. And he posted a mean review. So I tried to chat with him and find out what the deal was, but he didn't want to talk to me anymore.
You know, I think that happens to... it's happened to me sometimes, too. I'll play a game. I really enjoy it, but it gets hard and you get frustrated, and then you need to vent somehow, right? And then hopefully later on you come back and say, you know what, it's okay.
I'm actually considering adding a complexity scaling algorithm a little bit. Like if you die two or three times, I'll ramp down the boss or something like that, because some people have had problems. But what I found is if they go on the forums and they ask, people will give them seven or eight different strategies to actually win the fight.
Hmm. So why did you decide to go with this classless skills-based system? I mean, I imagine there's some trade-offs. I mean, I guess there's some advantages and disadvantages to it. Just wondering why you selected that.
Well, the key is that the game is really open-ended. And, you know, with 10,000 sectors, that's a set number of sectors. And then, you know, for every one of those sectors, you could have as many as, you know, 15 or 20 planetary systems in each one. That's millions of locations to visit, potentially, depending on, you know, the random seed in the game. I just wanted people to be able to progress in any way they wanted to, and build characters any way they desired to, just by using their skills. There are plenty of games out there that are class based, but I figured I'd leave that for, you know, the fantasy genre, which is very, you know, very much class-based. For this, I wanted something different. I wanted something closer to what, you know, had been done with Fallout recently. I wanted to be able to expand on that system and let people, for example, use melee weapons and a rifle and grow in both of those paths. And if they got tired of it and they got to a point where the perk system wasn't working for them or they needed a different strategy, they could go grind if they wanted to and grind some other skills up to a level where they were useful again and try that. So the idea was just really to allow people to have choices. That doesn't mean you can't have that in a class-based system, but it does mean that not, you know, your original decisions can limit your character set once you get to a certain point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can see some advantages to that classless system. I mean, I'm just trying to imagine a scenario in real life where somebody's like, "Oh, I'll be the tank," you know, and I'll be a DPS. I mean, it's not like that. So this feels more realistic to me, the system you've worked out.
Yeah, and you can progress yourself a tank in the game if you want. You just stick a lot of your stat points into certain stats, make your character a melee, and you're front line. You know, for example, the pugilist skill has some advantages. So if you're up front, you can stun characters with your fists quite a bit. So if you crank up your stats and you're a pugilist and you set your perks right, you're not going to get hit a lot. There are some other things that keep you from getting hit too, but I'm just saying that one of the innate capabilities of fists and blunt are that you stun more often.
Interesting. Yep. Yeah, I was thinking that when I was creating my... I spent probably an hour just creating my characters on this because I kept going back and forth with these different stats. I noticed you've got like a one-hand melee, two-hand melee, yep, and pugilism. And that's a lot of options there for, you know, basically up close physical attacks.
Yeah, and you know, I'm actually really pleased to hear that you spent so much time with the character creation. You know, that's one of the things I wanted. It's not perfect. It's a step down in complexity, certainly from wizardry, but it has enough there to where you can really get attached to your characters, and you'll, as you progress in the game a little bit, that might be interesting, as you'll find out, hopefully.
Yeah, I had some, I spent a lot of time picking out the skills and everything. And then when I got to the, I thought I was done, then it, you know, wouldn't let me continue. And I'm like, I must have missed something. And I went back and I figured out that I could actually put points into those red skills. Like, yes. As well as, for some reason, I just didn't even notice that. So then I had to go back and, like, recalculate everything else so I could have that pretty much covered. But, you know, it seems like the way the game, once I got into the game, I noticed that these skills will raise if you use the, like, I didn't put rifles on anybody, but they were still getting bonuses every time they used the rifle, right? So I like that it doesn't feel so critical that you get everything just right when you're creating the characters, right?
Exactly. It's more of a help. It's kind of a boost. So when you're creating your characters, you're also setting your initial weapon sets, except for a couple of weapons like heavy weapons. You don't get a heavy weapon or a submachine gun if you skill up in those because they're kind of overpowered. I may tweak that later. But yeah, the idea there was just to give you kind of an edge, and you can feel pretty much by the time you've left Dauntless, the decisions that you're making are actually making a difference in your characters. You can feel it when you're playing the game.
Mm, that's great. I mean, that's why we play this genre, right?
Yes.
So there's a lot of game here. You know, as you've said, I heard you say the same thing to Shane, that, you know, if you've only been playing this first little bit of the game, you're really only seeing a small sliver, you know, of what the gameplay experience is like. You know, you got the whole... you know, this ground-based stuff only lasts a certain while, right? And then you're off into space doing space missions. I just wonder if you could talk a little bit about the synergy between the space part of the game and these ground missions.
Sure. And, you know, the prologue of the game, too, gives you a little bit of a feel for that. Because you do get your first ship, and you get to do some exploration in that first system. The idea is the ship is more than just a transportation method to get you from place to place inside systems or in the FTL map, FTL space. It's also tied into your character skills, and your characters actually take stations on the ships, and you can move your characters around to various stations if you want. But as your ship enters into combat with enemies, or as you mine resources or even travel through FTL space, the characters in those stations gain skill. And as you gain skill, you open up opportunities to customize the character in a variety of different perks through the perk system. So it's more than the whole space component and the synergy between space and the characters is not just an afterthought or even a second game. It's totally integrated into the game itself. So you find yourself launching with your ship the first time, and you're just in the middle of this solar system with a mission to go meet this character. And the idea there is that it takes you to a station where in essence you pick up a mission and you end up traveling to a planet and you land on the planet and you have things to do there. So it really is, there is a really strong synergy between the traveling portion, your team members, your ship, and all the events that are taking place in the environment.
And one thing I thought about, I don't know if you've played this No Man's, have you played the No Man's Sky?
I have, yeah. Game? I picked it up on day one.
Yeah, I noticed that, you know, your game has this procedurally generated universe as well, so I was thinking about all of the, you know, it seems like people just don't really like No Man's Sky. I haven't played it myself, but a lot of the reviews said it just kind of got boring after a while. You know, I'm just wondering if you're, you know, as somebody who's designing a procedurally generated universe, how do you keep that from getting repetitive or predictable or boring?
Well, I think, and I'm not going to compare it to No Man's Sky because they are really different in their goals. But with Stellar Tactics, it's a lot different. The idea is your progression is the key in the game. And it's not just a progression through space to a certain central goal. It is more about how you want to build your team, with an end goal being how powerful can you be, how custom can you tailor your characters in this environment, and can you survive, in a sense. Though it's not a survival game, it does get tougher the farther you go from the center of the universe. So if you want to progress to get some of the best gear, if you want to progress to get some of the best sort of trading opportunities that are available in space, because there's space trading and things of that nature, you're going to need to build your characters and develop them. And that's just kind of the core sandbox. The story also drives you through the whole process. It's optional other than the prologue, but the story is there to actually give context to why you're there, where you're going, and it gives you some decision branches that really, as you get farther out into the universe, broaden your sort of where you can head, sort of, you know, good and evil, so to speak. And I haven't talked a lot about that, but that's kind of part of the whole decision-making process. And people have asked me, why aren't there aliens? And the reason is they're coming. And you find out about this in the prologue. Mm. They are coming. Yes. So there are aliens. They're coming. And they're coming fast, as fast as they can. So.
I remember talking to some of the other guys that have done procedurally generated games. I talked to some of the rogue developers. And I listened to I haven't gotten to interview them yet, but the Elite guys. You remember Elite?
Oh, yeah.
I remember one of the things that struck me about both was they said there was a point where they realized they were having a lot of fun playing their own game, you know, because the procedural generated stuff was just as, you know, fun for them as it would be for somebody else. And, you know, I think that's really different than designing most games, right? Because if you know where everything is, it's not as much fun for the developer. Obviously, as a developer or designer, you're not going to want to play this. Yeah. So would you say you're kind of like that, playing? Do you play Stellar Tactics and have a lot of fun playing it, even though, you know, you're the one that made it?
Yeah, you know, you remember, like, some forums, like D&D forums and places, people could choose what they are. Are you an explorer? Or are you a this or that? I'm an explorer. I like games where you can go out and explore. And the procedural nature of the universe is not to the degree of No Man's Sky. It's a little bit different, but it is fully procedural, and it gives you a complete new set of places to explore. It really randomizes, you know, things like where your best trade routes are going to be. It literally, you know, when you get down to the surface of the planet, you're not walking on the planet. You're kind of being sent down to locations that have tasks or activities for you to do. So I think for me, it's the ideal game, and that's what I'm making. I'm making the game I've always wanted to make, which is wonderful. I'm just excited I got as far as I did, because I've had some pretty rough patches where it was just like, why am I doing this?
Yeah, the animation system in particular.
Yeah, that's anyway. But yeah, I'm kind of at that point now where I'm actually really having fun playing the game, and now I'm starting to get feedback, which is great. And some of these ideas are really good and important. They're just total oversights on my part that make sense. So, but that's why I went with the procedural system, is I wanted to be able to play the game over and over again and have a different feel.
Yeah, you alluded to one thing. I wanted to ask this about being in, you know, the game being in early access. I mean, obviously people do that so they can help find the bugs and things wrong with the game. But I was wondering if it seemed like you have actually had some advice or feedback or people coming up with ideas. They go beyond just here's a bug, but I mean something that's really cool that you didn't think of yourself that you might actually put into the game.
Yeah, well, I think one example right away is that I had put in initially, which I thought was a pretty cool system of doing fine aiming, which when you place your cursor over a body part, legs, arms, head, chest, you could just do some little fiddling, a little bit of fiddling with the cursor to get kind of a bonus to hit chance.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and a lot of people didn't like it. They were really, you know, some people were adamant that that was a terrible idea. And I thought to myself, well, you know, I don't want to force people into doing things they don't like. So by default, now you get a fixed chance to hit, because that's what people were used to, because this was different. But you can hold down the Alt key and you can do the fine-tuned aiming. So that's one example, I think a good one, because it's a core gameplay element that came out of some of the early feedback that people have been providing. Another one was I had a tester, a person who was testing for me, and this person actually had a bit of a handicap in his hand, you know, a problem with his hand, and he didn't want to hack doors where he had to sit there and kind of time things. It wasn't comfortable for him. So I added an auto hacking feature, which you just click that and it just takes your stats and sort of figures out whether it's going to be, you know, I think Fallout actually added that in too. One of the more recent Fallouts, 3, 4. But those are two examples. And then on the forums right now, and I haven't had a chance to dig into this yet, but I'm going to, there is a feedback section and there's a ton of really good feedback in there because I've been peeking. But I haven't really had a chance to just stop. I'm trying to push right now to make sure that some really important things, like, for example, control, holding down control was one of the biggest complaints that I had, is that you couldn't really see the things in the environment. Well, that's going to be fixed really soon.
I was going to say, I'm glad you mentioned that.
It is an annoying thing. So now when you hold down the control key, you are going to see everything that could be interacted with, color-coded, and very vivid.
Big arrow here.
No, not that bad. But it's kind of a very bright color that with some glow. So you know, it does take you way out of the game. In other words, it's kind of jarring like that. But you can really see the stuff around. So, and I'll tune that a little bit. I'll tone it down if people go, oh, that's just really lame. But yeah, early access for me was all about I'm not in a hurry. I do need feedback because it's just me. And it's just a brilliant system if you're kind of in that mode where you really want to tinker and make a good game and get feedback to get the feedback you need.
You know, one thing I was just thinking about now, actually, as we're talking here is, you know, at what line would you get some feedback and you think that's a really great idea, but, you know, do I if I put it in the game, do I have to sort of share credit, you know, with this person? You know, I mean, at what point is it like that? That's something I would not have put in my game. If I put it in my game, it's almost like it's not my game anymore. I mean, I'm kind of having a hard time articulating this thought here. But
no, I get it. I mean, so for example, if somebody comes up with this fantastic idea that nobody's ever thought about, and it wasn't really a part of my original design, but I think it's so important to put in that, and it's big enough where somebody would deserve credit, I'd probably want to approach them and say, hey, look, this was your idea, and I'm not going to put it in the game unless you agree that, you know, I'm going to give you credit for the game, but the game remains mine. And it's just it's a legal thing. But I think there is a line there that you have to draw, which is that you have as a designer, and I can't really call myself, I guess I can call myself a designer, but I'm more of a, I don't know what I call myself. I wear all the hats, kind of a deal, which is kind of weird. There's only a
one-man band.
Yeah, a one-man band. There's a growing number of people like me that are just building it themselves. But there is a line you have to draw in the sand for your design and try not to step outside that. And the example is the feature we're talking about, which is the fine-tuning. That didn't really go away. It just got changed a little bit so people could have it either way. I'm not expecting any major jarring sort of course corrections on the core game design. It is what it is. But I am listening to people. I don't want them to be annoyed by the game.
that would be good.
Well, they are. I mean, literally, the one thing is the control thing. Some people, that's really bothering them.
I heard Shane even brought that up. I guess the left click or the right click to move was threw him for a loop.
Yeah, some people, so that's the other thing too, is some people like different keystrokes, they're used to it. So if you look at World of Warcraft, I hate to bring that up, but
why?
Well, I don't know, I mean, it's an incredible success, but their method for camera rotation is left, holding down the left or right button, you can rotate around your character. If you go to their auto movement, in other words, there's a key, or there's an option for moving by right-clicking, or by clicking, it uses the right key button. Mm-hmm. So I tried to mimic that a bit, but what I'm finding is that not everybody wants the same control scheme. So eventually I'll add a couple of options for folks.
Yeah. I think that's a good advantage of being the one-man band, is over the alt movement or whatever. Yeah, you can do that, whereas I guess if you were just a creative person and there's a producer might just say, you know, take it out.
Yeah. Some people, well, you know, for example, Blizzard, they make design decisions like Diablo 3, right? It's a 3D game, yet you can't rotate the camera. And that was a major design decision that they made that was really important to them, and it couldn't be changed because the way their set pieces work requires that it just be static. So but in a case like this, where I've got people being annoyed by some little things, I can fix those up for folks.
Well, I gotta say, playing Stellar Tactics and watching the movies and realizing how much content you've got here, and this is a really inspirational project. You know, in addition to being a fun game, just the idea that just a one man, you know, you basically can make something that looks this good and plays this well. You know, I think a lot of these sort of, I've played a lot of these sort of one-man band games, and I mean, you know, to be charitable, you know, you could sort of tell it's a, you know, right. It's just one guy, you know, you kind of have to give some leeway there, but I mean, you kind of set the bar pretty high for this. I mean, are you just some kind of mad scientist type to be able to pull this off, or is it just to the point where these development tools, you know, are such that you don't have to have a big team anymore?
It's a combination. So my daughter thinks I'm a mad scientist, but the truth is there are three factors associated with that. And one is I set the bar for myself because I know how to set the bar. when it comes to games now. I didn't when I first got in the industry. I just kind of set, and some people would argue that, yeah, it's not great. It doesn't look great. I've got a lot of comments like that. But
it doesn't look great.
Yeah, I've had comments from people saying, yeah, the graphics are so-so. And that's okay. I've got thick skin. And I agree. You know, graphics are... But I guess to answer your question, there are a couple things. Yes, the tools are much better now. There are more people available out there that you can contract with and get assets. There are asset stores, things like that, where you can pick quality content and tweak it a bit and use it in your game. And so I consider them set pieces. Like if you were playing D&D, you know, and you were building out something to play your game with, you've got like a little set piece and you can build things out with that. But the key is to be patient enough and to give yourself enough time to be able to say that doesn't look good enough. I'm going to start over again. And I've started things over a bunch of times and I'm still not happy with things. For example, the first area that you've been playing in, which is, the Dauntless, it's supposed to look kind of rough. It's supposed to look like it was welded together, with pieces, and it's a bit old and doesn't look great. It's kind of boxy. But ultimately, I'm just not happy with that area. And it could be like a year from now, I just rebuild the whole thing using new assets just because I don't like it. So that's what it is. And then the final factor is waking up every day and wanting to do it more than anything else. Well, other than family, but it's got to be like you've got to just wake up and want to do it every single day. And I've made some sacrifices to make the game from a time standpoint because I've got a full-time job. But I really, really appreciate you saying that.
That's encouraging. I mean, a lot of people are just like me and you, right? We've got full-time jobs. We don't need another full-time job and have other responsibilities. And you think, well, I would still like to make a game. But it's encouraging to think if we ever have that wherewithal that the game doesn't have to look like the...
Yeah,
you know, bargain basement type. It could actually look. I mean, I don't know what it blows my mind that people are complaining about the graphics on this. I don't know. Yeah. I'm not an artist myself, but I don't play it and think, "Wow, this looks amateurish." You know, I don't have thoughts like that.
Thanks. That means a lot to me because I know you play a lot of games and you've seen them and. You've probably been playing games as long as I have, and it's just amazing that a lot of people have said so many kind things about this game. And I've never seen a forum where people are as gracious and there's just, it's been really a great experience. I appreciate it.
One question I wanted to ask you, though, about the development engine you're using. I hadn't heard of it before. I think you called it a Shiva. Is that the name?
That's right. Yeah, Shiva 3. It's
Why did you choose that instead of Unity or Unreal?
Yeah, it's interesting. See, I'd worked with Unreal quite a bit in my development career, my professional development career. There were a couple... I looked at a lot of engines. I did look at Unity. I even purchased a number of other 3D engines and tried them all. And the one thing that I really liked about Shiva was that it used Lua script, Lua scripting language, which let me code things very quickly. But it didn't use the Lua script and interpret it. It actually compiled all of it into pure machine language or C code. So I could, if I want to, I can just take the game and export it as C++ and take it and stick it in another engine if I needed to. All the logic would still be there. That was really important to me because engines come and go. At the time, I didn't choose Unity because even though I could write the majority of what I needed to in C or C++, I didn't want to go there. It would have taken me too long to do all this work by myself. So, and then there was a third part, which was initially when I was designing this, I really wanted, when I started this, the Apple Store was a big deal and iPads were a big deal. Mm. Now you put your game up there and it's likely to just disappear.
You know, one of 2,000 new games this week, right?
Yeah, exactly. Well, it's the same, almost the same thing on Steam now. Though Steam, I'm pretty happy with Steam. I don't have any complaints. But yeah, so Shiva is different, and I think, you know, there was one point where the company reorganized, and I thought my engine was gone.
Uh-oh.
So, yeah, that was a big deal. Here I was 4 years into the game or 3.5 years into the game, halfway through it, and I thought I wouldn't have an engine. But that didn't happen, luckily, and Shiva's still alive and well. And they're actually working on a new version that will be good for the game, too. Some updated core graphics, rendering, PBR textures, things of that nature that are really important to kind of keep the graphics bar up if I, you know.
I'm not familiar with this Lua script. I mean, I've heard of it before. Why is that such a big deal?
Well, so in C, you have to be very careful with the way you code. You have to have your brackets in the right places. You've got to do all these things. Lua lets you be a little bit sloppy with all that, and it just it kind of the way the system is. I can write 10 lines of Lua code for 100 lines of C++. And it's just a real logical language, and Shiva, it's actually Shiva Lua. It's kind of like a modified version of Lua just for Shiva itself. So what it is it's a very powerful scripting language with a very powerful graphics API behind it, and a really powerful math library too.
All right, so I think we're getting pretty close to the end here. I was wondering, do you have an estimate as to when this might be out, or when it might be officially released? And what are your plans for it in the short term?
I could talk a little bit about that. I won't talk about when Alpha's going to be ready, because honestly, I just don't know. I think that would be rotten for me to say that for people, you know, to give people hope and then just in the end say, because I have some people really, really wanting more content. So what I will say is that right now I'm wrapping up the last few bugs, the last few major annoyances, adding a couple things that people wanted, including the highlighting. I'm working on a retooling of the data. So patch sizes are smaller. Patches have been a big deal. I was doing like a patch a day for a couple weeks, and it was almost a gig and a half of data. So those things are really close to being finished, and then I'm going to move on to content. So the first bit of content, and you're the first person to know, is going to be sort of a random mission system that takes you to one of the planets in that first star system, Akbedius. And you'll be able to talk to a person on the station who will give you a mission and with a preset set of rewards. And you can go down there, and every time you go down there, the sort of layout is going to be different. And it'll be the test bed for the global random mission system that's almost finished. Just I'm going to have to build a HUD for it or a GUI for it. And then you'll just be able to go down there and grind your hearts to your heart's content, which is what people want to do now. So that's basically what I'm going to work on next, because it's a core part of opening up the rest of the universe. I have to get that part done for it. And then after that, space combat's the next part. And then after that, wrapping up the trading system, and then we can almost be to Alpha. There's a few more bits in there.
Sounds good. I have a question here, a quick question from Shane. It's nevertheless, I think, a very important question.
Sure.
Are there rats in there? And if not, do you have plans to add that all-important creature?
Well, I have to say that rats are on my mind.
That's very comforting.
Yeah, that and that I do
just
believe,
regular rats, or do you have some kind of sci-fi rat?
They're not going to be regular. Nothing can be regular in this part of space. There's going to be some serious rat action.
Awesome. Awesome.
I have the rats.
Amen to that. All right, folks. Well, there you have it. Stellar Tactics. I'll put some links on here. You can check it out on Steam, of course. You can buy it, right? Or you can follow it on Steam. But beyond Steam, is there other places people can go? To, do you have a developer's blog or anything like that people can read?
Yeah, so two things. You can buy the game through Steam, or you can buy it through my page, through Humble Bundle, and I get a bigger cut of the game.
Through
Either
Humble Bundle.
Humble Bundle?
It said you get a bigger cut through Humble Bundle.
Yeah, I do. And the deal with that is it's just if you go to my webpage, www.stellartactics.com, and go to the store, you'll have the option to either buy through Steam or Humble. Humble gives me a little bit more to work with, but if you, both of them give you a Steam key. So
right.
In the end, you're getting the same thing, and it's all going through Steam.
Just to get automatic updates and all that good stuff.
Yeah, all that good stuff. I'd considered putting it on GOG too, but it's not time for that yet. So that won't be happening anytime soon. Perhaps after the game releases, it will go up on GOG. GOG.
I think in any Kickstarter or, you know, Figs or anything like that, maybe.
What I'd love to do? I'd love to just do this full time. It would be great. Right now, I just can't. If I detect that there's enough interest in the game, I may try to run a Kickstarter just to fund me through the completion of the project, at least. But as it stands right now, I don't have any plans for a Kickstarter. I did run a Kickstarter earlier this year, and it didn't pan out. Within 4 days, I could see that I wasn't going to get the numbers I needed, so I pulled the game. Yeah. Part of that is my fault, marketing.
Marketing?
Yeah, you know, it's my weakness. I just don't market myself or the game as well as I should. If I could hire a full-time person to help me with marketing, that'd be great, but that's the way it is with a small game.
Well, Don, thanks for taking the time to chat with me. Is there anything else you wanted to mention about Stellar Tactics or anything else that we didn't cover yet?
No, I don't think so. I want to thank everybody who's bought the game and given me feedback. That's just, it's amazing. It's been really, really, there's been a great reception for the game. And I'm just going to keep working on it. And I really appreciate you bringing me on the show.
Well, my pleasure.
Yeah,
it just amazes me. I know so many people that have these big ideas, the great ideas, you know, but they run out of steam and before they get anywhere. And you've actually got this really promising, I guess you're calling it pre-alpha.
Yeah.
So I really, really hope you'll stay in there through to conclusion.
I will. Yeah. This is my thing. I think I told Shane the same thing. It's this is not going to end. I'm going to keep working on it. I'm even more motivated today than I was 2 years ago to keep going. And instead of working on a Shelby Mustang in my garage or model trains
or something like that.
Yeah, this is what I do. You know, this is my thing. So
yeah, that is the thing. I was just in a hobby shop. I just kind of randomly went to this big hobby store. They just have a new hobby store here in town, and I didn't realize there was so much you could do with this model train hobby. I mean, it's immense.
Yeah, and it's actually pretty cool. I mean, you could just build amazing environments. I knew some people who were into it. It's.
I mean, I could see how people can get into that. I really can.
You got to have some space. You know, if you've got space in the garage or if you've got a basement or something, you really do need some room to get it done right. But you could just spend countless hours with all the cool things they have for...
Don't think about it too much, because we don't want you to...
I'm not switching the model train.
I've had it with Stellar Tactics. So go to...
Yeah, that's not going to happen. I got past the animation part, so now I'm good.
That's good. All right, folks. I think that'll do it. So go check it out on Steam. And thank you, Don. And good luck.
All righty. Yeah, thanks very much.
that's all for this week's episode. Hope you guys enjoyed that. I should be back next week. Not quite sure if I want to jump right into some new interviews that I have in the can here. Got some really great ones coming up. David Wesley, Dr. Cat. Those are just going to be really, really awesome. But, you know, I might want to do a little game review in between. So we'll see what happens. Stay tuned, and then you'll know first. As always, I want to thank you very, very much for your support of the show. Really means a lot to me, guys. Really, truly means a lot. If you would like to step up and support the show, just go to that link in the show notes to the Patreon site. All I ask is $1 per episode. I know you guys should be able to afford it, but if you can't, that's okay. You can always support the show just by telling your friends about it, posting about it on Facebook and what have you. Whatever you guys do to support the show, I really appreciate it, and thank you. Also, I want to remind you, the holidays coming up, I know a great book. Actually, I want to recommend the pair of these books, Vintage Games Consoles and Vintage Games 2.0. I think these they really work together to tell the complete story of the video games industry. So if you haven't read these yet or you know someone who might like them, please consider adding those to someone's stocking. All right, what about that news for the Matt Cave? Oh man, epic news time here at the Matt Cave. I don't even know where to start. Just out today, let's start there. So just out today, Planet Explorers. This game's been in early access for a while. It just has its official release today. If you don't know about this one, it's an open world sandbox adventure RPG set on a distant planet. Uses the OpenCL calculated voxel system to allow players to change the terrain. They can also create new objects such as weapons, vehicles, and blah, 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 and do it anywhere. So that's $24.99 on Steam. Go pick that up. And then even more exciting, this happened back on November 4th. We got the game Dungeon Rats, quite possibly the best named RPG of all time. This is a turn-based, party-based RPG set in the Age of Decadence world. You guys probably remember my review of that game. Good game. This one, though, is focused on squad-level tactical combat. You're fighting your way out of a prison mine and frequently dying in the attempt is your idea of a good time. You've come to the right place. And that one is only $8.09. $8.09. Not sure how they arrived at that figure. But it's only going to be that cheap until November 11th, after which it will go up 70 cents. Anyway, it's a little bit of a savings, right? So it's cheap. $8, guys. Come on. Dungeon Rats, $8. No brainer. Go pick it up. I haven't got to play it as much as I want to. I've been having a lot of fun with it so far. And then finally, this is one of the Stigs news items. Stig's always sending me these things. This was a trailer for something called Project Wight. Pretty interesting looking game. We don't know when this is coming out yet, but we know it's developed by a team called The Outsiders, and that team is led by David Goldfarb, who did Battlefield 3 and Payday 2. Anyway, this is a much different kind of game than either one of those. This is the premise. Rather than seeing the hero charge in to destroy NPCs, it asks what an RPG trope is like from the perspective of the other characters in the game, namely the Outsiders. They say it's inspired by monster movies, surrealist poetry, heavy metal album covers, and a book called Grendel by John Gardner, which tells the story of the Grendel monsters from Beowulf, the poem, from the monster's point of view. So pretty good set of inspirations there. Anyway, this looks really cool. Check out the trailer, and I'll try to keep you posted as I learn more. And meanwhile, if you hear more about the game, please send that on to me. All right, I think that'll do it for the news. What about that ale of the week? this week I've got a little number called the Alm Duddler. Alm Doodler? Alm Duddler? Don't know how to pronounce it. something out of Austria. It is a natural alpine herb soft drink. So it's got a pretty cool picture on the can here. I thought it's kind of the same colors as a Coca-Cola, but when the first time I saw this, I thought it was some kind of weird little Coke special kind of thing. But then you're like, whoa, this is an herbal alpine drink from Austria. Quite a bit different. I can't read really anything on the can. It's all in Austrian. I know, guys, German. Let's see. Water, sugar. They do have a little sticker here in English. Water, sugar, carbon dioxide. Whoa, like a lot of carbon dioxide in my drinks. Acidifiers, citric acid, coloring, ammonium sulfite, natural herb extracts. Keep cool and dry. Product of Austria. Anyway, I just love the artwork on this can. Anyway, let's get this Alm Dudler open and see what it's all about. All right, so I got some of this Alm Dudler here in the rather excellent drinking horn. Well, I've never smelled anything like this. It smells a little bit like the inside of a paint can, with some other weird sort of aromas in there. Not quite sure what exactly it is I'm smelling. I don't know what herbs they used. What, they say something about alpine. Smells kind of like chemicals. Like, whoa, maybe I shouldn't drink this. It's probably turned somehow in the can, and this will probably kill me, but let's give it a go. Yeah, man, I don't know what's going on in Austria, but people like this? You know, it smells sort of like a nostril full of some sort of paint can-like chemical. Taste-wise is, that's descriptive. Let me try it again here. Yeah, I don't know what to make of this. And when I poured it, it was fizzing up, like it's got a lot of carbonation in it. But it tastes kind of flat. I don't know how they managed to achieve that. It's got some, I guess these are some herbs I'm just not familiar with. I don't know what this tastes like. It's not very sweet, though. It's kind of, let me try one more time. Oh, the things I do for you guys. I don't know how to describe this. Maybe kind of a coal tar, menthol, a little bit of a menthol-like flavor to it. Maybe a little bit of a pine. Just kind of making stuff up at this point. Anyway, I don't know who would enjoy something like this. Maybe it's an acquired, I'm guessing it's an acquired taste, right? It's not really horrible. Oh, heck, let me try it again. Yes, it's sort of like a flat Pepsi with a little bit of a bitterness to it, and a sort of a chemically like aroma. Again, not for me. It's interesting, I'll give it that. I'm gonna go. I don't want to start a war with Austria, so I guess I'll go 1 out of 5 drinking horns on this. If you're looking for something weird and you don't mind a little bit of a chemical taste, go for Alm Dudler. Yeah. Okay. Let's wrap this up with a quotation. And with this election going on, I was looking for quotes about elections. And I found one that I thought was really fun and probably truer than we want to think about. Anyway, the quote is by Otto von Bismarck. It goes something like this. People never lie so much as after a hunt, during a war, or before an election. See you guys next week.
37. I'm not old.